అఘోరా 2 కుండలిని చాప్టర్ తంత్ర టైమ్ ఎక్లిప్సెస్ అండ్ నైట్స్. ఇన్ హిస్ యూత్ విమలానంద హ్యాడ్ స్టడీడ్ ఆస్ట్రాలజీ విత్ జీనా చంద్రసూరి అండ్ ఐ ఫ్రీక్వెంట్లీ విట్నెస్డ్ హిస్ అమేజింగ్ ఎబిలిటీ టు క్యాస్ట్ అన్ ఎక్యూరేట్ హారోస్కోప్ ఫ్రమ్ ఎ విజిటర్స్ ఫేస్ అలోన్. దో ఆస్ట్రాలజీ ఈజ్ ఎ రెస్పెక్టెడ్ మీన్స్ ఆఫ్ డయాగ్నోసిస్ ఇన్ ఆయుర్వేద, ఇట్ ఈస్ నో లాంగర్ టాట్ ఇన్ ఆయుర్వేదిక్ కాలేజెస్. I held out some hope that Vimalananda would teach me himself. But every time I asked for instruction, he would refuse, saying, "You have more important things to learn right now." He relented only with regard to those aspects of astrology which he felt would be materially beneficial to my sadhana. "Do you remember the three wise men?" he began one day. "Sure," I replied confidently, for I had learnt their names in Sunday school, Balthazar, Melchior, and Caspar. "Right. One was an Egyptian, one an Assyrian, and one a Babylonian. They all followed the cult of the Magi, which originated in Babylon and was practiced in all three countries. It was a sort of tantra. These three men performed their calculations independently, and when they met and exchanged notes, they found that they had all independently reached the same conclusion: a prophet would be born. Then they set out to follow the star, and they found Jesus. This was a unique occasion, of course, but it shows the practical benefits of astrology. In fact, knowledge of time can pay dividends in all sorts of ways. Suppose you should find a rare white flowering flame of the forest tree. Suppose you should find a rare white flowering flame of the forest tree. This in itself is not so easy. I have found only two in the whole state of Maharashtra, and they are entwined together. If you can find one, though, and if you can take its wood during a certain astrological conjunction, you can work wonders with it. You can even fly, but you must collect the wood at precisely the right moment. All of Tantra is based on time. If you do something at the right moment, you get the result. Otherwise, no. Do you remember the first night you came with me for Homa? Of course. Do you remember what we did with the cow dung? It took me a moment, but then it came to me. We took some cow dung, mixed it with water, put it in a pan, and then balanced a pestle upright in it. And that pestle remained upright as long as the eclipse continued. As soon as the eclipse ended, it fell automatically. You saw it. How do you explain it? How will scientists explain it? I have no idea. We explain it on the basis of the strange gravitational effects that eclipses cause. Eclipses are excellent for people like you and me because their gravitational effects multiply the effect of our sadhana. If you do 100 repetitions of your mantra during an eclipse, it is like doing 100,000 repetitions on an ordinary day. If you offer one oblation into fire, it is like 1,000 oblations. And nothing beats this time for offering prayers and performing rites of your deceased ancestors. Of course, any time period which is this powerful can have negative effects also, so some precautions are in order. Never look at an eclipse. The rays have a very disturbing effect on the mind. A pregnant woman should not even go outside during an eclipse, lest her child be affected. Take nothing internally, not even water, while the eclipse is going on, and for as long as possible, up to 12 hours before and after. If you can follow this niyama, you can make any eclipse work for you. He had told me all this before. I waited patiently for him to get to his point. Eclipses happen irregularly. Of course, you cannot rely on them. Fortunately, though, predictable moments of enhanced sadhana occur every year in every season. India is such a wonderful place that even our festivals occur at those times when success at specific forms of worship will be easiest. The rishis systematized these festivals in order to help sadhakas become clairaudient and clairvoyant. For example, Ma, the great goddess, is worshipped during these periods of 9 nights during the year, because during these periods it is easiest to come into contact with her. The rishis who created the universe are well aware of the effects of the various yugas on our minds. They also knew that these doctrines that we have been talking about are far too complex and subtle for the average individual. So they created seasonal festivals. When the common flock celebrate their festivals, their minds become somewhat detached from the mundane and attached to the spiritual, while those who know the esoteric significance of the festivals use them to spur their spiritual progress. The festival season in the fall begins with Shravana, the month in which Shiva is worshipped, during which Krishna is born. Then comes the Ganesha festival, followed by the fortnight during which the ancestors are placed. Once both Ganesha and ancestors are happy, Kundalini can be safely raised, which happens during Navaratri, the 9 nights which are sacred to the goddess. Finally, we have Deepavali, the festival of lights sacred to Vishnu in the form of Krishna, which each vertebra of the spinal column becomes a point of intense pure light. The spring festival season is similar. It begins with Ganesha's birthday, followed by Mahashivaratri, which is, as you know, the most important night of the year for Shiva worship. A fortnight later comes Huttashani or Holi, a harvest festival which commemorates the balancing of the demoness Holika, and after another fortnight, another Navaratri begins, which culminates in the birth of Vishnu in the form of Rama. The birthday of Anjaneya, the monkey god who is an incarnation of Shiva, follows 6 days later. During these various festivals, there are 4 important nights, Ratri, which are ideal for ritualists like me because they are meant for specific practices. The first is Maharatri, the great night, which is Mahashivaratri. It falls every year on the night before the new moon during the lunar month of Magha. The second is Kruraratri, the cruel night, which is Holi, the next full moon after Maharatri. Then comes Moharatri, the night of delusion, which is Krishna's birth night. Krishna deluded everyone with his Maya. It falls in the month of Shravana, usually during August. The last is Kalaratri, the black night, the night just before Deepavali, the new moon of the month of Ashwin. Deepavali occurs in October or November. On Maharatri, people try to stay away all night long because it is said that Shiva will come just for a moment or to anyone who does not sleep at all. But Shiva is too clever for us mortals, and almost everyone who tries this nods off for at least a minute or two just at the moment when Shiva is near them. He has to test those who want to see him, doesn't he? I suppose so. I had already tried this a few times and had dozed off as predicted for a few moments each time. Kruraratri commemorates the burning to death of the demoness Holika by her nephew Prahlada. Holika possessed a magic cloak which would incinerate anyone who wore it. Her brother Hiranyakashyapu, Prahlada's father, ordered her to kill Prahlada by throwing the cloak over his shoulders. When Holika took Prahlada on her lap, he realized what she was going to do and slipped out from under the cape. As she unfurled it, the cape fell on her and burned her alive. It took great power to destroy Holika, and that sort of power is obtained more easily at this time of year. Kruraratri is useless for anything auspicious, but it is excellent for practitioners of black magic, especially the Shatprayoga, the 6 rituals which cause death, delusion, discord, hatred, obstruction, and enchantment. Moharatri is meant for worship of Krishna, and Kalaratri is best for sadhanas, meant for obtaining control over spirits. A number of things can be accomplished on that day, like Munda Sadhana. Munda means skull. You require 5 human skulls for Munda Sadhana. 4 are placed in the corners of a square and 1 in the middle. In between each pair of human skulls, you put the skull of an animal. Which animals you use depends on the specific ritual you are doing and the result you want to obtain. When all the skulls have been properly placed and aligned in the proper direction, you cover the whole thing carefully and sit on top of it. Then you begin your japa. Do not try this on your own. When I want you to do Munda Sadhana, I will tell you. Though Munda Sadhana interested me, I knew it would be useless to try to press him for details, and so another question formed in my mind. Vimalananda answered it before I could speak. You have more than once asked me why, if Tantra is such a wonderful thing, the 6 rituals exist at all. This is a good question that has more than one answer. One reason they exist is to protect society. A priest has the responsibility to help defend the kingdom in which he lives, and these 6 rituals can be used to kill enemies of the state, to sow discord among foes, or to entice wavering rulers into alliances. They thus become agents of policy. They are also used in romance, business, and so on, but with little justification. The Panchamamsa sacrament. Central to many tantric texts are the rites of Panchamamsa, the 5 M's, and the Panchamamsa, the 5 great spiced meats. Since these passages in the tantras are written in symbolic twilight language, they present several layers of outer, inner, and secret meaning. The drawing shows the Homa rite of the 5 great meats, which are compounded to produce pills that confer various siddhis. The drawing shows the 5 meats of a man, cow, elephant, horse, and dog boiling in a Brahmin's skull with the 5 ambrosias of fat, feces, urine, blood, and semen. The skull rests upon a fire pit of human heads above a downward pointing triangle fire mandala and an upward pointing wind mandala. The rite of Panchamamsa has a direct resonance with the practice of Munda Sadhana. More important than any political use, however, is their use in sadhana. Suppose you want to make use of enchantment. If you perform the prescribed ritual correctly, the first effect will be that all the women in your neighborhood will begin to find you irresistibly attractive. I had read about this. One text says, in fact, that they will rush to you oozing copiously from their swelling, dangling vaginal lips, meaning that the desire created in them by this ritual will completely overcome their modesty and discrimination. So I interrupted. This is some sort of super duper aphrodisiac. No, it is not essential that women become sexually excited when they are exposed to this effect, but because most people strongly self-identify with the body, most women will inevitably experience this attraction sexually. Attracting the women is not so difficult. The difficult part comes after they have been enchanted. If your mind is firm, you will not be tempted at all by these excited women. You will continue with your ritual, knowing that you are making progress. Soon the enticement will extend to other female beings, especially those in the ethereal realms. If you can resist all the temptations they will offer, then you will eventually attract the attention of a female deity. If you are sure of yourself, you may request her to teach you like a Bhairavi. If not, you should regard her as a mother and not permit sex to have anything to do with the relationship. Then you are made. Wow. So I think you will agree that the 6 rituals can be quite useful. Indeed, I did. Enticement is certainly one way to achieve, but in my experience, it is not as good as way as pure selfless love. It is not easy to preserve your balance of mind when a passionate yakshini, demigoddess or naga kanya, serpent princess entwines herself around your body, but there is no danger of falling when you can say to God honestly, make me an ugly prostitute for thousands of births if you want to, but always keep me near you. When you can honestly say this, you are ready to become a true devotee. You must begin all sadhana with niyama, but you do not have to practice niyama forever. There will come a time when you will be so absorbed that you will remember the deity at all times, and that stage you won't be able to remember how many repetitions of your mantra you are doing, much less any niyama. Finally, you will forget even to repeat the mantra, but that is a much higher stage. Hazrat Bulle Shah, who eventually became a great saint, was very conscientious early in his career about following a strict niyama. After keeping track of how much japa he would do, he counted his japa one by one on his japamala, until one day he overheard the milkmaid who brought him his milk talking to her best friend. The milkmaid was in the habit of giving milk away free to her lover, and the friend asked her, don't you keep track of how much milk he is drinking? How else can you know how much he is eating into your profits? The milkmaid replied, can there be any accounting in love? My profit is the love he gives. Hazrat Bulle Shah sat stock still when he heard this. Then he looked at his rosary and thought, the milkmaid has taught me something today. If I really love God, can I do any kind of accounting with him? What a fool I have been. He threw the rosary away at once and never used one again. In the beginning, a rosary is useful, and strict attention to time is essential. Once you become devoted, however limitations lose their meaning in devotion, just as in romance. There is no such thing as the limitation of time or space. If you can remember what time it is, you have no capacity for love. Nyaya. But since right now I do know what time it is, I said all these anushtanas and so on will not only help awaken any mantra, but will also help me develop my devotion. That is right. Are there other practices I should know about? I asked, knowing well that he expected me to continue asking even if I did not know what to ask. Well, there is Nyaya. Very few people talk about Nyaya because so few people know about it. But without Nyaya, there is no Tantra. Nyaya was another word that no one had been able to explain to me clearly and accurately. So I began to pay even closer attention. Nyaya, when comes from the Sanskrit root meaning to place, helps infuse your being with the power of the deity you are worshipping by placing that deity in your body. If you have already purified yourself to some extent by removing a good bit of the heavy overlaying of filth in your consciousness, you have dissolved part of your old being. This is a type of khanda. Now the deity's ethereal body can be invoked into you, and his or her limbs will take the place of the ethereal limbs which you have dissolved or chopped and burned by your sadhana. Nyaya is important because it enables you to identify yourself with your deity. The more you think of and visualize your deity, the subtler your consciousness becomes. When your thoughts have been perfectly transformed so that there is no khandana of projected desire, then your being is transformed. Nyaya also helps you by balancing the energy in your physical body and making it steady, which makes your worship steady. Steadiness is always best in sadhana. That is why I encourage all my children to repeat their mantras mentally. Mental recitation is best because of the problem of pronunciation, and also because it enhances the firmness of your consciousness. When you recite a mantra, nothing in your body should wag, not your limbs, not your cock, not even your tongue, nothing. Only when you are absolutely still and stable can the mantra's shakti fill you. Your movement will distort the effect and we can eat. When about the people, what about the people? You claim that when you recite your mantra, your body will automatically begin to move into strange contortions, which proves you are making progress. I knew what this answer would be. It is all just so much bull. If you are singing kirtans and bhajans, you may be so overwhelmed with devotion that you will begin to dance. That is a good thing. It shows that your kirtan is doing what it should. Kirtana actually means kartana of karmas. That I indicates that it is doing done musically. As your karmas are cut and you feel lighter, won't you dance? But this has nothing to do with mantra sadhana, for which your body must be firm. When you do it properly, nyaya can be very powerful. Once in the jungle, I met an old sadhu whom I saluted respectfully. He got wild. Why don't you touch my feet to show respect to me, like you know you should? You insolent young fool. I told him, Maharaj, I am happy to do that, but I have been busy practicing my nyaya. If I touched your feet, you will be finished, which I don't want to happen. That is why I do not touch your feet. If you insist, give me your wooden sandals and I will salute those. When he did, I touched them and they turned to powder. He got the shock of his lifetime and realized what kind of force he was dealing with. I do not claim that I am so great and powerful, he added, seeing a certain glint in my eye. This is just the result you get when you do these practices correctly. I remember you are telling me that each syllable of the Vedas is supposed to be pronounced with emphasis on a different part of the body. Is this a sort of nyasa? Yes, there are so many things that are only hinted at all in the texts that most people never even suspect their hidden meanings. Always remember that both the Vedas and the Tantras are interested in the external mainly as a symbol of what is going on internally. Consider this, that aspect of pranayama which is concerned with holding your breath is called kumbhaka, from the word kumbha, which means pot. But which pot? I had no idea, which seemed to irritate him a little. Since I had been studying yoga, I supposed he expected me to know, but no one had yet explained it to me. So how was I to know? Here the pot they mean is the pot of the torso, the chest and abdomen, in which you can store prana. You have seen how a potter makes pot. Here you make a pot by making your body completely steady. Once this happens, you can proceed to the stage of Kevala Kumbhaka, when there is a cessation of breathing for minutes at a time. Only when there is Kevala Kumbhaka can your mind become completely firm and your worship will only be as steady as your mind is. So, this is what pranayama is for. Pranayama is for what its name suggests, control of prana. Most of the people teaching yoga think that this means you should achieve control over your prana by holding your breath. But kumbhaka does not mean actively holding your breath. It means the balancing of your inhalation and exhalation so that they cancel each other out. For kumbhaka to be of any value to you, it must be effortless. You must learn how to forget to breathe. I have never told him the details of how I have strained myself by trying to hold my breath in the approved yogic way, but I knew that he knew anyway. Suddenly, I became aware of how little much most people who try to teach yoga really know about it. So, as far as pranayama is concerned, the pot means the body, but do not assume that pots always represent the body. Oh no. What meaning a pot or anything else has depends on the specific practice. Every part of a tantric ritual is significant, but you cannot just do guesswork about it. You have to know its precise meaning. You probably have seen that in formal ritual worship, there is always worship of a pot. During Navaratri, when we worship Ma, a pot is the central focus of attention. The pot, here called Ghata, is infused with Shakti in the procedure known as Ghata Sthapana. Now, what do you know? What do you think the pot represents here? I didn't hazard any guesswork. Here, the pot is the part of the head filled with Amrita and other juices or hormones. Just as during the ritual, the pot is filled with water before Shakti is invoked into it. We worship the pot to make our minds firm and to fill our minds with energy so that our worship during the nine nights will be totally steady, which will help to awaken Kundalini in a controlled way. Exactly. As soon as you learn to control your Kundalini Shakti, she will be at your disposal. But remember, only one who knows Shakti can control her. If you hang a sword on your wall, it may injure a child who tries to play with it or a servant who comes to dust it. As long as it exists, even for thousands of years, a sword retains its inherent nature, which is to slice, to sever. This is the true test of Shakti. There should be no limitation of time. Another reason why it is difficult to control Kundalini. You should say, why is it almost impossible? Because the average person's personality is simply not strong enough to deal with cosmic energy, which is why I say over and over again that the only safe way to awaken and raise Kundalini is to personify her. Convert her into a goddess and worship her, love her like your mother, and then you will be safe. I always prefer to call Lord Shiva's grand consort Uma instead of Parvati or one of her other names, because Uma is made up of the same letters which make up the word Om, which is actually Om. Uma is not inherently different from Om any more than Shakti is different from Shiva. They differ only in form. U stands for Vishnu, the preserver. Uma is therefore U plus Ma, the mother who always protects, who shields the child from any danger or calamity. What can be higher than that? You can achieve Uma if you can learn how to love her. And if you want to learn how to love Ma, you need to learn how to love her creations. Every being has its own variety of love, some of which we humans cannot even comprehend. I personally think rocks have the best form of love because they are so stable, so firm. Once they love you, they never change. A rock has its own forms of expressions that you may not be able to understand. Suppose you heat it. After a certain temperature, it starts to flow. It makes an offering of heat and light to you. How many people understand how to love a rock? Very few. But those who do know something of how to love Ma. He left me with that thought to think about until our next conversation at the end of the next Navaratri. Vimalananda usually went into retreat during Navaratri, fasting and repeating mantras, requesting his beloved Tara to enter and enliven him. I loved to meet him on the day he finished his worship, for he was quite a sight to see. His entire countenance would be filled with an intense otherworldly radiance, and the talks he would give in the expansiveness of that mood were particularly pleasing. On this occasion, he began, even yogis and sadhus are not spared the poison of ahankara. One day, someone was reciting some verse from Tulsidas, and suddenly my friend Chotu said, "Why are you repeating what those fellows used to say, as if it were because of them that they had written it? If they were really sincere in their absorption in God, why should you have added their own names? Why should they have added their own names to so many of their verses? Was it necessary for them to write so often, Kabir says or Ravidas believes or in Tulsi's opinion? Why should that ahamkara of name be there? Why should they worry about whether future generations will praise them as the authors? If their words are really prasadika vani, then how can the poet be considered the author at all. The other fellow did not know what to answer. What could be answered? Chotu was right. Sometimes Chotu says the most amazing things. So even doing intense sadhana and developing great devotion, as all these saints did, is no guarantee that ahankara will be totally kept in check. I suggested, it is no guarantee at all. So long as you retain your individual existence, ahamkara must identify with your personality even to a very teeny extent. And even a single thought of me and mine is enough to ruin everything. What is the answer then? I asked despairingly. The answer, you know the answer. Throw yourself at God's feet. Offer everything you have to God, including your very existence. If your donation is honest, God will accept it and will direct your path from then on. So long as you always remember him or her. The moment you forget God, you return. I have told you many times, and I still maintain, that it is much easier to surrender to a personal God than it is to surrender to some cosmic forum. It is all well and good to appreciate the vastness of the cosmos, but how can you grab hold of it to love it? You cannot, but you can grab hold of Krishna or Ma or whoever though and love them. Mental worship. Now, although there are many different ways to worship, I have always believed it is best to worship mentally if you can. Physical worship is always limited, especially now during Kali Yuga, when not even the experts are always able to do their physical worship properly. Even the most proficient devotee must occasionally make a mistake in his or her ritual. Even the best trained mouth must sometimes mispronounce a mantra, and in some sadhanas, if you make even a minor mistake, you are gone. To avoid all possibility of error, it is always better to worship mentally instead of physically. There is nothing to misplace, nothing to spill, and no fear of mistake. This is what the tantras mean when they call for internal sacrificial rites. Do you think this is so easy? In almost every case nowadays, only the show remains. The internal techniques have been lost, except to the chosen few. You can do any sort of worship internally. I have taught you to perform Homa, no doubt. But Homa is an external form of worship, and its limitations are those of all other external forms of worship. It is often easier to do external worship in the beginning, so that you do not have to visualize everything you are offering. But everyone must eventually progress from external to internal worship. The special value of Homa is that it purifies the fire element, which controls the sense of sight. As the fire element in your body becomes purer and your Bhutagni increases, your ability to visualize, which is utterly essential for internal worship, will improve. You are going to learn quite a lot about internal worship by the time I am through with you. Let us start with fire worship. Even if you cannot perform Homa with an external fire every day, and how many people can nowadays, you can still do Homa every day and get benefit from it if you offer to your digestive fire everything you put into your mouth. Yes, it is not so pure as a well-tended external fire, but it is always ignited, always ready to accept offerings. You do not even need any special mantras. Just offer each bite with the mantra you repeat daily and see the result. This is a form of internal worship. Orthodox people go to temples, but I believe that the true temple is inside the mind. Why waste time worshipping physical objects when you have everything you need inside your own mind? Your concentration will be much better if you perform internal worship, because you do not have the distraction that trouble a person performing external ritual. The constant worries of obtaining the right substance at the right time, misplacing something, spilling something else. It is much easier to self-identify with your mind when your mind is not distracted by external things, even if they are your articles of worship. On the inside, everything is always ready for your use. If you make the effort to locate it, it is useful to worship in a temple that is filled with Shakti, true. But how many of those are these nowadays? A temple will be useful to you only if its Prana Pratishtha has been properly performed. Prana Pratishtha is the rite by which life force is infused into the image, making it live. Every temple has had a Prana Pratishtha done for the image which is worshipped therein. But if the Prana Pratishtha is not done properly, the image will not come to life. You can test this at the very end of the Prana Pratishtha ceremony when a mirror is offered to the image, so that deity which has been invoked into the image can see itself. If the job has been properly done, the mirror will shatter. Only then can you say the image has any power, not before. Even if an image has no power, it can still act as a focus for your mind to concentrate on. Of course, the only disadvantage of mental worship is that the mind has no such focus until you create one. There is a big disadvantage for most people. Yes, it is. Many people come to me and claim to meditate for 1 and 2 hours at a time. I always tell them, first learn to concentrate and then you can meditate. Try to concentrate on one thing for every 3 minutes, and you will find that it is impossible unless you have had long practice in that department. Then try to imagine keeping all your articles of worship fixed in your mind for an hour or more, and you have an idea of the effort required for real mental worship. But it is definitely worth it. Once there was a poor man by the name of Bulaki Das who worked as a farm laborer for a big landlord just so he could get something to eat. He got into the habit of taking a half-hour break before his lunch and performing mental worship. After some time, he found it so enjoyable that he began to sit for an hour, then 2 hours, 3 hours, and sometimes longer. The other laborers had no idea what he was doing, of course, and became indignant about it. They told the landlord, who came out to the field one day to see for himself. Back then, landlords could do anything they pleased to their workmen. And in this case, when the landlord saw that Bulaki Das was not working too, he gave him a good kick. Bulaki Das awoke from his trance and said, "Oh my, look what you have done. I was giving food to all my saints and only the yogurt was remaining. But now you have disturbed all that." Then he opened his hand to show that the yogurt which had been in his palm had fallen to the ground. Bulaki Das's concentration has been so intense that the yogurt was actually created in the physical world as a result of his mental worship. When the landlord saw the little mold of yogurt on the ground near Bulaki Das's hand, he immediately realized his mistake, bowed to him and took him as his guru. They both became saints. They belonged to the Sant Sampradaya like Dadu and Rajab. There is nothing higher than perfection in mental worship. You can actually create whatever article you offer mentally, just like Bulaki Das did. You do run the danger of becoming totally useless to the world, of course, because the joy you get from your mental play is far more intense than any physical joy you might experience. When you advance far enough into mental worship, your duty will come and play with you, and then you get yourself absolutely lost in that play. Beautiful. It almost sounds too simple, I said suspiciously. Well, let us put it this way. Even a Pashu can somehow or another perform ordinary physical Adibhautika worship, but Kundalini must be least partially awakened if you hope to perform internal Adhyatmika worship, since only when Kundalini is awakened does Bhutagni become truly ignited. And without a strong Bhutagni, you will never be able to create a fire firm image in your astral body. But there is another form of worship also, the astral or Adi Daivika. Let us assume you are worshipping Ganesha externally. You can offer things dear to Ganesha, such as sugarcane, into a physical fire with an appropriate mantra. Internally, you offer your mantra of Ganesha into the fire of your Bhutagni. You must make use of your personal goddess, your Kula Kundalini, in order to perform the Adhi Daivika worship. Kula Kundalini is essential to Adhi Daivik worship because only Kula Kundalini knows how to locate Ganesha. If you want to do Adhi Daivika worship, first make your Kundalini Shakti descend to the Mooladhara Chakra, where you make herself identify with Ganesha, the preceding deity of that chakra. Kundalini can self identify with anything by her perfect self identification with Ganesha. She actually becomes Ganesha, and then Ganesha himself performs the worship. Only when the deity exists within your own body can you do perfect worship. Then you know exactly how to propitiate him or her because you have become him or her. And so the tantras say, first become Shiva and then worship Shiva. How else you can comprehend Shiva unless you have become him? Just as I was about to proceed with this line of questioning, some guests arrived and Vimalananda definitely changed the flavor of the conversation. Clearly, he expected me to work on this for a while. Ganesha, Vimalananda delivered the next in this series of musing at a Ganesha temple. I can no longer recall which temple it was, for he was very fond of Ganesha and we paid regular visits to several images of elephant-headed god. The area around Pune has been associated with Ganesha worship for centuries, and Ganesha is still one of the most beloved of deities of that region. After we had finished our worship and were relaxing, he began to address me thus, "You have to be able to deal with all sorts of temptations when you start to raise Kundalini, because your prana will try to move in unusual ways. This is why sadhana of Ganesha is so important. Ganesha is Gana plus Isha, Lord of the attendants. Usually people think of the Ganas as spirits who are Shiva's attendants, but in Kundalini Yoga, the Ganas are the sense organs. Ganesha is Lord of the senses. He is also called the remover of obstacles, because if he becomes pleased with you, he will remove all obstacles from Kundalini's path as she rises. The Mooladhara, where Kundalini sleeps, which is the seat of the earth element of gross physicality, is ruled by Ganesha. This is why you must worship Ganesha before you worship any other deity. You must request Ganesha to permit you to go beyond your physical nature to admit your consciousness into the astral regions. Ganesha's blessing is essential for Kundalini to be able to leave the Mooladhara Chakra. You know the story of Ganesha's birth, I think. I did. Parvati, Lord Shiva's grand consort, created Ganesha from the dirt on her body to protect her privacy while she bathed. Ganesha was on guard when Lord Shiva arrived and wanted to go into his wife. Ganesha prevented him from doing so, and since Shiva did not know who Ganesha was, a battle ensued during which Shiva slew the boy. When Parvati came to know of this, she became so enraged at the loss of her child that she threatened to destroy the entire universe, and would have done so had Shiva not placated her by replacing Ganesha's severed head with the head of an elephant. Then she calmed down. And now what about the esoteric meaning? I am not sure. Ask me about it. The name Parvati means she who is born from the mountains. In this case, the chain of mountains known as the spine, within which resides the spinal cord. Parvati is the Kundalini Shakti. Chain is a good word to use here. Unless you awaken and free Kundalini, the spine acts as a chain to bind you down to earthly existence. Ganesha was created from the dirt on her body, the earth element, the earth associated with the Mooladhara Chakra. Shiva, the individual's consciousness, tries to break through to the dormant Kundalini by force, but this threatens to be the end of the sadhaka, because the Mooladhara is the root support of the body. When Shiva realizes this, he regenerates the Mooladhara with the help of an elephant, a beast known for its intelligence. If you want to awaken Kundalini, therefore it is best to allow this intelligence to direct the awakening instead of barging in like a bull in a china shop and wreaking havoc on yourself. Instead of meditating on the Mooladhara Chakra and trying to forcibly open it is wiser to transform it with Ganesha's help. Now here is a question for you. How did it happen that Lord Shiva, who knows past, present and future, who is Parvati's husband, how did it happen that he could not even recognize his own son? A good question. I could not open my mouth. Think about it for a while. You know, Ganesha is one of the gentlest of gods. If properly approached, most beautiful and very sweet. But he can also get upset. He is a small child, and you know how children can be when you become angry, when they become angry. And think of how wild elephants can be when they become angry. When Ganesha does lose his temper, he changes in a moment from the remover of obstacles to the creator of obstacles, and then you are in real trouble. Once I gave a man a Ganesha mantra and told him that after 40 days of repeating it, Ganesha would come and stand in front of him. I knew this story well, but Vimalananda's tone of intense seriousness altered me to be strong desire for me to listen to it yet again. Unfortunately, something happened to break his niyama before the 40 days were up, so I ordered him to start all over again. Finally, after he completed 40 days, nothing happened. I told him, "You are very close now. Do not stop. Continue it for just a few days more." The man said, "Look, this is all foolishness. There is nothing behind it. I cannot stand being away from my wife. I am going home now to have some good sex." I warned him, "You have gone too far for that now. Ganesha will become very angry if you do that, and I won't be able to save you. Just do it for 3 more days and I guarantee that you will succeed." What more could he have wanted? It was only a question of 3 days, but Mahakala, the death of God, must have already grabbed hold of him. He told me, "No, I am through listening to you. I have really got to go have some good sex. Goodbye." At first, his wife tried to prevent him from climbing on top of her, but he forced his way into her anyway and enjoyed her twice. Satisfied with his labors, he fell asleep. In a dream, he saw an enraged elephant charging at him. He tried to run, but it was useless. When the tusker caught up with him, he gave the man a solid blow to the jaw with his trunk. The next morning, the man's entire face, jaw, and all were swollen to twice its original size. He was taken to the hospital. The doctors could not find out what was wrong with him. I went to the hospital too, and he asked me from his hospital bed if I could rescue him. But there was nothing I could do because his nervous system was blown to shreds. It was too late. He had gone too far. He died that night. After that experience, I decided I would only assist people in their own sadhanas and never suggest new sadhanas to anyone. Iron discipline is necessary whenever you commit to a sadhana. Without it, something is sure to go wrong. So do not start trying for this kind of perfection of a mantra unless you are so obstinate that you will finish it. If you decide that you must have meat for a few days or that you must have drinks or sex, then you are ruined. Not only will you never succeed, but you will have to suffer for trying to act smart. If you know your willpower is limited, it is better not to do anything at all. To break your vow and then say, "Oh, I will ask forgiveness of God and he will look the other way," is only cheating yourself, no one else. Once you commit yourself to a sadhana, you are really at risk yourself. You finish it off properly. Do you mean that God will not forgive any mistakes? Of course not. God is always ready to forgive. If you go to him with humility, but there is nothing humble after this sort of sadhana, you are demanding attention from God. You are saying, "Come on, I want to play with you on your terms." If you tell God that, then you had better to ready for whatever God wants to dish out. Chapter completed. Om Namah Shivaya. Srimatre Namaha.